Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to call to order our city commission meeting this evening. We're glad to have you with us. We're going to have our pledge allegiance this evening led by Commissioner McCord and our invocation by Commissioner Holberg. If you'd please rise and join us.
Please face the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please join me in prayer. Father, we are here today to ask for your blessings and guidance in the performance of our duties as elected officials. We pray for strength, love, knowledge, and understanding. Help us to recognize and solve the problems that are presented. Make our solutions fair and just to the best interest of everyone. Help us to overcome our shortcomings and keep us united as a team to work for the betterment of the city and its people. We pray in your name. Amen.
Thank you all.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to approve the agenda.
We have a motion to approve the agenda as presented. Second, Mr. McLemore. Any discussion? All in favor, please raise a hand. It's unanimous. Now we have the great honor to recognize our firefighter Marvin Clark of Griffin Fire Rescue on his retirement after 27 years of service to the city. All right, Chief Jones.
Okay. Good evening, Commissioners. It's a shame to see all this experience going out the door at one time. But once again, we are here today to honor a good friend, Marvin Clark, who has been with us for 27 years. And he was with the city of Griffin previous to the fire department, and we were lucky that he came over. I can tell you a lot of wonderful things about Marvin, but one of the things I would like to highlight really quick is the fact that between 75 and 100 times a year, an American firefighter is killed in the line of duty. Most of those are cardiac arrests, but the second leading cause of death among firemen is a vehicle accident. And it's really not because people are not yielding the right of way. It's because there are just not enough qualified drivers operating those very expensive pieces of equipment. But I will say, Marvin is absolutely, and his captain, Phil Reed, the Lieutenant Meeks here will agree, he's absolutely one of the finest engineer drivers you ever could work with. He will get you there really fast. and really, really safe. And it's just such a shame to see that, especially when about 3 weeks we're about to take delivery of probably one of the most impressive pieces of equipment you'll ever see, and that's a $1 million ladder truck. And I wish Marvin was going to stick around and drive that for us, but he said he's got to go. But he's been a wonderful mentor and friend, and he has been very active in the Black Professional Firefighters Association. But I would like to point out something he probably has didn't realize, but we had he was checking his truck out. This is how thorough this guy is. He was checking his truck out one morning, and he noticed something was not quite right. So he called Captain Hamilton, who called Stevie and Phil over at the shop, and they found a problem. And they said if that truck would have rolled out the station and he had not have called it, it would have cost over $10,000 to repair what happened. But so he saved us a lot of money. And Marvin said he'll take half of that in cash, if you don't mind. But anyway, Captain Gilreath, Lieutenant Meeks are here with him. They had the honor of serving with him, and they may want to say something. But I would like to go ahead and present, Mark's got his flag here. Again, tradition, we lower the flag on their last day of service, and we will present that with him. And Marvin has a wonderful plaque here. We hope he'll grace his home. So let's congratulate Marvin Clark.
I won't say much. Tommy stole part of what I was going to say. But anyway, I had the privilege to work with Marvin. I was his captain, and that's his lieutenant over there. And I want to reiterate what Chief Jones said. And, you know, we have a lot of bad calls any given time during the year. And some of them are bad wrecks. Some of them are fires. And the one thing that we didn't have to worry about was getting there safely, or if it was a fire, you know, worried about the pump and getting the appropriate lines and things that we needed. Marvin Clark always took care of that, so it took a big load off of me and the lieutenant here. And I kid Marvin all the time. I tell him to hang in there a little bit longer so he could wait till I retired before he did. But he went ahead and jumped the gun, and the shift loves him. Marvin's a great guy. We've learned to be really good friends, and he and I have learned to, we'll sit around sometimes and talk about the community and how God's been good to us, and how we try to bless other people. Being a fireman is a very rewarding type job, and it's one of the best jobs that you could ever do. And I'm going to miss Marvin. I know Andy's going to miss Marvin, but we wish him well. Everybody knows when it's their time to leave. And I will say one more thing that's kind of funny. On Wednesdays is a day that we have to completely clean the station, do all the windows, and we just do like a turnkey job. And that wasn't one of Marvin's favorite days. So I told Marvin, I said, look, I've already talked to Chief Jones. I've talked to City Manager Kenny Smith. And you're more than welcome to come by every third Wednesday that we work and help us out. Now, so far, he hadn't took us up on it. But anyway, we're going to miss him. He did us a fantastic job. And not only was Marvin a good driver, but he's also a very good person. And he does a lot of things for people in this community. He helps them out a lot. So I appreciate his work ethic and the way he did me and my lieutenant a good job, and I wish him well.
First, I just want to thank God and for a job. It paid my bills, and I enjoy doing it. And I'm going to go home and relax now.
Mr. Clark, for you, do you have anybody you want to recognize?
My wife is here.
We'd like to thank her for allowing us to have him for 27 years of work for us. Thank you. And, Mr. Clark, 27 years of service like this and the words they said, it means a lot to us in the city, and your dedication and hard work for all that time is very much appreciated, and we hope your encore career is great fun, and God bless.
Well, another thing, too, when I first got here, I was riding on the back of the fire truck, holding on. When I left, I was driving it.
Now, that's moving on up, as they say, right? Next part of our agenda is citizens' comments, and this time I will open the floor to comments from the audience. Comments should relate to a specific agenda item not listed on the agenda for a public hearing or to concern within the jurisdiction of the city. Our meetings serve the purpose of conducting business and are not a forum for the unlimited expression of opinion, and the chairperson reserves the right to limit comments to matters germane to city business and may refer speakers to the city manager or other staff for resolution. Having said all that, do we have anybody who would like to come forward and address the commission? And we'll start on my left over here. Anybody want to come forward and have anything to say? Okay, anybody on the right? All right, seeing none, we'll move on. Go to our public hearing section. And public hearings are conducted to allow public comment on specific advertised issues such as zoning, ordinances, policy, budgets, and other legislative actions considered by this commission. Item number two on the agenda is to receive comments regarding a request to rezone the property located at 1201 Meriwether Street, consisting of 0.35 plus or minus acres from low density residential LDRB to planned commercial development, submitted by Mr. Cleed M. Mirza. Mr. Toussaint, our director, will address. Good evening.
Good evening. The site, if you haven't noticed, is the old Spruces location. It is zoned LDRB, which is the residential zoning, but it has commercial use on that location. So the applicant is asking to rezone the property from residential to PCD, which is commercial, so they could use the site as a convenience store. The rezoning does not necessarily match the future land use map, but if you know Meriwether, it's a lot of commercial structures located along that corridor that are zoned residential. So staff and the Planning and Zoning Board have recommended approval of the request.
So both the staff and the Planning and Zoning Board have recommended approval of this?
Yes, sir.
Anybody have any questions for Mr. Kirk?
Yes, sir. Are there any conditions or anything, or any way to make sure that the property's porous condition right now to make sure it?
Well, it hasn't been used.
An asset in the community?
Right, it hasn't been used in years,
yes,
so
sir.
They would have to bring it up to code to even occupy the location.
There are no stated conditions on the rezone.
No, sir.
All right. assume the applicant stands behind us here. Do you have anything you want to say, sir? And you're Mr. Mirza?
Yes, sir.
Good evening. Could you give us your name and address for our record, please?
Khalid Mahmoud Mirza, K-H-A-L-I-D, Khalid, and last name is Mirza, M-I-R-Z-A.
Okay.
And 1147 Meriwether Street, Griffin, Georgia.
Okay, thank you. Do you have anything you'd like to say?
Yes, sir. You already decided this is already commercial property, but that was closed. So maybe city cancel. So I come over here to get as a commercial man.
You have been the victim of one of those citywide rezonings many years ago that made it residential, evidently. Any other questions? This is a public hearing. Does anybody else out there have any comments or questions? Yes, sir. Would you like to step forward and take the podium? And will you give us your name and address for the record, please?
My name is William F. Young. I have a business I've had for 33 years on Meriwether Street. But I live at 124 Runnymede Road.
Yes, sir. Mr. Young.
I spend more time on Meriwether Street than I do at home.
I know you do.
These are two of the finest people that I can think of that has bought this property to do something with. My concern is we have enough alcohol already on that corner. In this neighborhood, we have drug problems. It's a cadre of things. We don't need any more alcohol or anything sold out of that building. If you could do away with all of it, you would probably do away with half of your problem in that corridor.
Okay. I'm trying to think. That's a separate issue, the alcohol
yes.
license and qualifications,
yes.
but I understand what you're saying.
Exactly.
Okay.
The other thing I have is the trash that's... I've been... traveling lately, and you go to cities, and the first thing you look at is how clean they are. We got a problem in Griffin, Georgia. I'm sure you all are aware of it. It's not going to do anything at this meeting, but it's going to take everybody to clean it up. You see it? Pick it up. Don't walk by it. Don't drive by it. Do something with it. Somebody drops the trash off in the middle of the road, it stays there for 4 days before some, I guess it just gets disintegrated. But people need to take pride in Griffin. I grew up here. I've got a lot at stake. Raised my children. Gone to public schools. So I care about Griffin. And I care about Meriwether Street because it's becoming a major corridor and an entrance way to Griffin, to downtown. And I hope you'll take my comments. Thank you.
We do. We appreciate them. And I think it's one of our major frustrations. I know in my office, I go out daily and pick up trash that people throw down, and it's very frustrating. It's an unpleasant sign of the times, evidently. But we have to battle it all the time, and we hear you loud and clear. Thank you. Mr. Kirk, anything else you want to say?
No. Again, like I said, it's going to be used as a convenience store. It's already built as commercial, so it only seems logical to... approve that request.
Okay. Any other questions or comments?
Is there intent on alcohol at the location?
Hadn't even gotten that far, actually. You can ask the applicant if... I don't know.
That part of the...
It's not part of the zoning application. It's a separate issue. It'll have to be dealt with at that time.
Thank you.
Okay. Anything else, anyone? All right. Seeing none, we'll move on to item number 3. We're going to receive comments regarding... request to rezone the property located at 812-814 Every Inn Road, consisting 0.58 and 0.29 plus or minus acres, respectively, from low density residential LDRB to PCD planned commercial.
Yes, sir. It's basically the same situation. You have a commercial location.
What did? Do you have a battery handy? Speak loudly.
All right. So again, no commercial location.
the motion really ought to be either a 6 foot or an appropriate foot privacy fence, okay? Okay.
You said they were the ones that, where the new fire station had been built?
It's a body shop. Came to resemble a junkyard.
How do we deal with commercial zoning where the body shop, where they do repairs, but then cars end up sitting there for years and decades, and then we got issues all up and down Experiment Street? And how do we make sure that this doesn't become a junkyard? Or at what point does a car that doesn't have a tag that's been sitting on a property become a nuisance to the community or the neighborhood?
Yes, speak up. I hope we can come up with some way to do it, because this accumulation of dead cars becomes a real eyesore and a nuisance.
So you've got residential property right adjacent to this, so.
Correct, correct.
And so.
Well, there is some law, which I don't remember the details of, that if somebody doesn't pay for the work, you keep the car for a certain time before it comes yours. Ownership transfers, but we need some way to minimize the years of collecting dust. Any other questions, comments? Anybody in the audience got a comment on this? Galloway, you represent the applicant.
We support what Mr. Kurt said. His staff report covers this very well. His recommendation covers it very well. Mr. Neal got caught in the comprehensive rezoning that was done. He had an automotive use that was a tenant in there that ended around the middle to end of 2014. Then the building sat vacant, and then a new tenant became available because interested in the property because of the fire station move, and then he went to come down here to apply for business licensing and so forth, and ran into the zoning issue, which he was not aware of.
The grandfathering
that's
expired.
That's correct. And I might add also, I would like to thank Mr. Smith for working with Mr. Neal on this and being able to cooperatively deal with the zoning issue and getting the other business moved. So we support the staff report. We support the staff recommendation. The property, with a little bit of humor, I will tell you that in front of the Planning Commission, I noted that the one error on Mr. Kirk's report was that he said the property had no historic significance, and it does, because I grew up in the house right behind it. So it's of great historic significance to me. The property went from being the RC Cola facility in Griffin to being Mr. Neal's Bandag facility. So it has always had an automotive use. Now, the way to deal with cars on a facility is what the ordinance requires, which is screening and fencing. And Mr. Neal's agreeable to the staff recommendation, and he is, as Mr. Kirk has discussed it tonight, and is willing to work with the city to get that property appropriately screened. That's going to be the owner's obligation from the standpoint of enforcement. But it has always been, trust me on this, automotive. My father and Mr. Neal had some run-ins sometime about the use of the property on occasion back in the 60s, but it has always been automotive.
Yeah, it's been ag for a long time.
Correct. Thank you.
Any questions, comments? Anybody else? Any questions, comments? Yes, sir. Mr. Young. No, sir. We have it on the record.
They call me the mayor of Meriwether Street. Have any of you gone out and looked at that property? I did. I see it every day. It is some improvement there, but I don't want it to become like Experiment Street, and it's beginning to look like that. I don't know how I could get another car in there. The property is too small for what he's trying to do. I mean, he has them packed in there like dominoes. I don't know how he can move them around. So, if you would, go out and look at it before you make a decision on it. PCD is fine. I don't have any problem with that. But we don't need another junkyard up on Meriwether Street in that area.
I understand. And going from a body shop and cars
right.
to a long-term repository is an issue, so
exactly.
I agree.
That's what I'm concerned about.
Thank you.
One last thing. So, you know, I understand the concerns, but with everything that happened, all of a sudden, he found this location to relocate. You know, it's the best spot you get, you know, within a short period of time. So, as far as the cars being there, that's something we will definitely look, take a look at and work on. But those are all the cars that came from his old location. So he had to maneuver to make it happen. So. But we will address.
In a way, we created this because we went and bought the property
right.
out from under him to build our new fire station,
right.
and he had to relocate
and
quickly.
And the only other difference is on this location, it will be screened versus on the Experiment. We can't necessarily require him to screen it since he's been grandfathered in.
Okay.
Right in there for a while.
He already has the tenant, the same tenant that came from over there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, it certainly can't stay residential and have. That would be a travesty, keep it residential. So we kind of, in my opinion, we kind of have no choice.
So option in terms of plan commercial district versus neighborhood business district, could
you
what can or can't, and I think also back to the other one.
Well, just you look at the future land use map, it calls for commercial. So it coincides with what's there now.
But is it less intrusive commercial than potential scrapyard?
Well, we got a sort of a conflict here from wishful thinking and reality.
Well,
I mean, you know, the next lowest thing is neighborhood business district, so that wouldn't fly on that street. Because across the street you have an industrial zone.
Right, there's industrial across.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yes. Anything else? We'll move on. Number four item begins our consent agenda. Items 4 through 12 are routine, either second readings or previously budgeted and approved items. Does anybody have anything on consent agenda they want to remove and consider individually? Seeing none, we'll take a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Make a motion to approve.
Stolberg.
Second.
Ward, second. Any discussion? Not all in favor of the consent agenda, please raise a hand. Unanimous, 6-0. All right, on to our regular agenda. Item number 13, consider a request to rezone the property located at 1201 Meriwether Street, consisting of 0.35 plus or minus acres from low-density residential B to LDRB to planned commercial district, submitted by Mr. Mazza, as presented. Discussed. How say you?
Question, please.
Okay.
Mr. Kurt, if this was rezoned neighborhood business district, could a convenience store be put in without alcohol?
A convenience store could be at that location. Alcohol is still subject to our alcohol.
I understand that, mm-hmm. but can you have in neighborhood businesses.
It's not on the corridor for a package store.
Right. Wherever the corridor, the only place you can have a package store is along the certain corridors. And Meriwether, it's on the...
I'm trying to understand why can and can't go there.
Right, a package store can't go there. Anything from MLK back towards 362 going out of the town, you can have a package store there, but not within Meriwether.
So package store, they can't sell beer, wine. They could though, it can be in store and sell beer and wine?
Now, package store to me means like distilled spirits.
A convenience store that sells alcohol under the commercial...
That's more of a convenience store that sells beer and wine.
Okay.
They couldn't sell liquor.
But if it was neighborhood business district zoning instead of PCD, could you, then if it was a neighborhood business district, they could have a convenience store, but they would not be allowed to have sell alcohol?
No. Even if it's a neighborhood business, you know, they still could sell beer and wine as long as they met the requirements for the liquor license.
Now, there's a church that's right around the corner from there. Is that...
It depends on how far the church is from that location.
And for information, we talked about the alcohol ordinance this morning, so I'm just trying to... Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
We have a motion to approve. Well, I move we approve.
I make a motion to approve.
Okay. And there's a second. Discussion. A motion, a second to approve. Any further discussion? All in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed? I think it's unanimous. Okay, moving on. Item number 14. Consider a request to rezone the property located at 812 814 Everian Road, consisting 0.58 and 0.29 plus or minus acres, respectively, from low density residential to planned commercial district. Planned commercial development, I should say.
Make a motion to approve.
I have a motion, Mr. Holberg, to approve. Second. I'll second. Discussion. I have to say, I don't know what else you'd do with this old Band Aid property. So, planned commercial is about the best you can do, I think.
Is there any kind of distinction when it comes to a use like that between a body shop and a junkyard anywhere in our...
No.
Or have you made it neighborhood business district commercial?
Yeah. Neighborhood business would be kind of a stretch on that strip of road.
Yeah, we're kind of playing word games here. This was the old Band Aid tire store, and it sort of is what it is.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, the place is obviously commercial.
Right.
Obviously in that condition, but I know we struggle with some other corridors that we've been looking at where, especially at the fire station, where we see that as an opportunity to clean up some areas. So,
right. In
a way, it does feel like we're shifting a potential junkyard, but at the same time, I agree with Dick. I'm not quite sure if we don't make any distinction, I'm not quite sure what you do otherwise.
Well,
because the body, I mean, ultimately, you're going to have cars that are being worked on there, and so it's probably a pretty fine line between how long the car stays there. But
right.
I think that's something. If you can make that distinction, I think that's something worth pursuing.
That's something we probably have to define more so than anything else.
In the zoning table now, 7.3 in the zoning ordinance.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you. What?
In the zoning ordinance now, in table 7.3 for permitted uses, you are allowed to have an automobile repair shop in PCD. You cannot have one in your neighborhood business district. You can't have a junkyard in either one. So if it does get to the point where we do believe it is a junkyard, then they can be cited under our zoning ordinance for failure to abide by the permitted use in the PCD.
So the vehicles don't have tags in after 6 months or 12 months? To me, it seems like it becomes a nuisance in terms of being junked, salvage vehicles. At that
it was
point,
a nuisance at the other location.
It was.
But we never cited them. You know, it's
like it existed first prior to that distinction.
Yeah.
Well, you didn't have the right to cite them.
You could, depending on what the level of trash or junk there may be, it might be a nuisance, but you could also cite them for not having a permitted use in that zoning jurisdiction.
Is there not a limit to how many vehicles or pieces of junk they can have on a property?
There's not in this definition on this table, but there may be something that we should look into in state law if it gets to that point, yes, ma'am.
and the way, there should be, you know, like in other businesses, you have to have a certain amount of parking spaces or, so that you can have, you know, but on this other property, this stuff was just on the side, on the back, turn around, upside down.
More than likely, the parking spaces will probably be met, because it's not for that type of use. You don't need that, yeah, based off square footage, and you don't need that many parking spaces. Because I'm not sure what it says in the ordinance, but it may be based off of this office space, which has a lower parking requirement than if it was a bigger warehouse.
But if I have a commercial property, mm-hmm. and I have a car that does not have a tag that's damaged, I'm going to get cited. So why don't we have that same impact?
Well, I mean, I guess we could look into that, but again, it's a body shop, so.
I don't have a problem fixing cars. My problem is if it sits there for 6 to 12 months to 2 years to my kids grow up.
And that may be something that you could also use your junk unoperable vehicle ordinance,
right.
which is a separate title in 90-142, is your junk unoperable vehicle. So you could look at it in that respect too. You're just going to have a little bit of a harder time proving from body shop to junkyard, but if there are several vehicles that have been there for years or months or whatever that case may be, that's going to be up to the prosecutor to prove to the judge.
Well, I'm gonna tell you, I'm gonna vote for this because I think
okay.
it'd be unfair to the property owner not to, since it's been that all along. But
I
do believe we need to take a serious look at this ordinance, figure out how we could effectively limit the accumulation of junk cars over time, and what it evolves from a repair shop to a junkyard.
So what I'm hearing is there is that distinction in our ordinance. That you are saying that distinction is there.
There is a junkyard distinction. There's a junkyard permitted use, and there's also an automobile repair shop permitted use. There's not a junkyard permitted use in PCD. That's in an industrial
right.
zone. But you are allowed an automobile repair shop in PCD. So if we have a couple different options in which they could be cited if they violate what we believe to be more than a body shop and turn into a junkyard.
Okay. Any other discussion? I'm sorry, we had a motion. I'm sorry.
I just want to say that I believe that, you know, the right thing to do is to rezone the property. But because of prior history, our prior history is not with the owner, but with the tenant. I can't with a good conscience vote for it.
Okay. I'm sorry, I forgot. Do we have a motion second? We did, I thought. Okay. Okay, any further discussion? Not all in favor of the rezoning, please raise your hand. 5-1 opposed. 5-1. Thank you, Mr. Kirk. And that's a tough one, I understand. Item number 15. Consider approval by resolution to amend the City of Griffin's operating capital budget for fiscal year 2015-16 in the amount of $20,844,903.70 and fiscal year 2016-17 in the amount of $15,222.73 for projects that we will complete in fiscal year 17.
Make a motion to approve.
Second. Those big numbers get me. Any further discussion? All in favor? Unanimous. Item number 16. Consider approval for purchase of one 265 XP30F self-contained compactor for use at the Topan USA Inc. from Waste Quip Inc. The NJPA and State of Georgia approved vendor for the total price of $19,772.20 and amend the Commercial Division of Solid Waste Department fiscal year 17 operating budget accordingly.
Okay,
Ms. Ward's a motion to approve. Second. Any questions of Mr. Francis? If not, all in favor? It's unanimous. Item number 18 is non-existent. So the City Manager report, Mr.
17.
17.
I'm sorry, you're right. Item 17, consider consulting agreement with Pam Allen for the municipal court.
Make a motion to approve.
We have a motion to approve and a second, Ms. Ward. Any discussion? All in favor? It's unanimous. Okay, now I got them all. City manager report. Mr. Keller, do you have anything to say?
Other than we've been in touch with George EPD on the drought issues, and we feel like it's our best interest not to go to mandatory out water restrictions at this time. The caveat to that is if Still Branch Reservoir is at 748 or below in February, we'll be going to outdoor watering strip mandatory restrictions before the season starts next year. So right now we feel comfortable where we're at. That's it.
Okay. Jessica, you have anything?
No.
Let's
go. A couple things. Want to thank staff and the community for the support of the Doc Holliday Blues and Barbecue Festival. It was a great success. A lot of good times. So thank you on that. Remember, the Spalding County Fair is coming up. And again, want to thank staff for their support with the Kiwanis Club getting things ready to go. Downtown Council is trying to promote membership. So at this point in the year, they're offering free memberships to all businesses in downtown. We're going to start going on a monthly meet and greet this week or next month. First, second Tuesday, we'll go to Subway, meet with the new owners, and then go out and spread out. So there's some new young life in the downtown council that wants to make it happen, so that's exciting. On the junk vehicles, I think this is a great time for maybe us, for Jessica, to look at the issues, and maybe we have that as a workshop issue, how we can address these supposedly car lots. You can think about Experiment Street, Broadway, West Taylor Street, North 9th Street. There's numerous places that have cars just sitting there that have been there for forever. Since I was a kid, I've never seen them. And so we need to look at how to figure that out. So if we can put that on the budget, maybe in the next month or so. And finally, we have a guest here tonight. Miles introduced me to Clayton County Commissioner Felicia Franklin Warner. If you could please stand if you'd like to say hey. She heard how awesome our board works together, so she came down to visit us tonight, and just want to welcome you to the City of Griffin, and thanks for coming, and who knows, she may be the person that gets us commuter rail one day.
We hope so. Thank you.
Thank you for being here.
It's a real pleasure having you along with us, and we do work together pretty well. We go out and duke it out beforehand, so we come in ready to go.
Back to I want to thank all of the commissioners for coming out for the Jolie Mathis. thank the staff for putting that together, helping us get that put together to honor Mr. Mathis out at the City of Griffin Golf Course. His family was very pleased, and it was just a great Griffin Day. So thank you, everybody, for your participation in that. Thanks.
Maybe we don't get along so well together. We take a little sarcasm here.
No comment.
Ms. Ward? I just have one. Oftentimes, we give credit to athletes and folks, and I think we forget some of our young people that are good in school and academics and other things. And I just noticed the paper that the Griffin High School Student Council President, Courtney Nicole Britt, is a recipient of a book award and so on. By Metropolitan Atlanta Alumni Association Beta Kappa. And she is the daughter of our police captain, Donald Britt, and his wife, Wanda. And this obviously is a bright young lady, well on her way to the proper path. So I think we sometimes miss recognizing some of our young people that we had to recognize, and I wish her the best. So Captain Britt is a fine officer in our police force. He's obviously got a sharp daughter. Anything else?
Make a motion to adjourn.
Motion? Second? All in favor, please rise.